most importantly of all,
when can we expect the next installment of the series? Spoiler alert, it might be a while.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me! Hello, Internet! Welcome to Game Theory, where last time we began unraveling the puzzle that is Petscop. To make sure everything is clear, let me quickly summarize our findings from last time in the form of a timeline. So the story begins in 1977 when a dude rocking some sick eyebrows named Marvin takes his female friend and her sister to a windmill, as you do. The friend, who's named Tiara, is killed by Marvin. Marvin then goes on to marry Tiara's sister, a woman who would eventually come to fear him. So clearly, Marvin is set up to be our bad guy. Now, fast forward the story 11 years to 1988, when we know our next key character gets born, Michael Hammond. We know this based on his gravestone. He eventually disappears, kidnapped and abused by Marvin, leading to his premature death at the age of 7 in 1995. In the aftermath of Michael's death, his older brother Rainer starts developing the game Petscop in 1996, which he specifically says is, quote, for Marvin. It's a game that he would complete a year later in 1997, as evidenced by the copyright date on the game's start screen. Around the same time, June 5th, 1997, Marvin kidnaps his own daughter, Care, a girl who bears a striking resemblance to Tiara, Marvin's first victim back at the windmill 20 years earlier. 8 days after Care's kidnapping on June 13th, a note appears on a copy of the game Petscop that reveals a password, which unlocks a hidden game buried under the surface that seems to expose all of Marvin's crimes. And that is where we left off, a battle between Rainer, the creator of Petscop, and Marvin, the serial kidnapper slash murderer. But this still leaves us with a ton of unanswered questions. Why would Marvin kidnap his own daughter? What is he actually doing to any of these kids? Why would Rainer create a video game of all things to catch the killer? And how does all of this relate to the videos that we're watching and our Let's Player Paul? So pluck those eyebrows, ladies and gentlemen, and watch out for any stray windmills, because today we're putting the final touches on one of YouTube's longest and creepiest Let's Plays. Let's start today by taking a closer look at Marvin. Coming off of the last episode, I saw a lot of people asking why he would kidnap his own daughter, but you honestly needn't look any further than episode 11 to find your answer. In episode 11, we watch as Paul unlocks a
frozen house.
Marvin's house, that we're told was captured at three different points in time. And we can tell exactly when those moments are based on calendars found posted on the wall. Now, they don't specifically specify the year, but we can actually see how the dates align with the days of the week and extrapolate the year from that information. The first has Christmas falling on a Thursday, which, by checking past years, we know happened back in 1997, which just so happens to be the year of Care's kidnapping. The episode makes sure to linger a lot on this particular calendar, showing off a strange pattern of days highlighted in green, beginning at the top of the year as every other day is green, then reducing only to weekends, and then skipping a few days before turning into a solid block of green for a series of months. In those few images, Rainer, through the language of the game, has shown us a tale of a family falling apart. Basically, what we've just seen is a custody calendar. Marvin sees his daughter Care every other day at the top of the year, then his custody starts getting reduced to only weekends. Until finally on June 5th, he breaks into his old house and kidnaps her, resulting in a solid block of green until November 10th, the day that she's rescued. In other words, he's kidnapping the daughter that was taken from him by his wife, and that block of green is all the time they're spending together now that she's under his imprisonment. And like we discussed last episode, it's a kidnapping that we actually see, as the second calendar on the wall confirms that we're watching her kidnapping, June 5th, 1997. And the last calendar we see puts us at Christmas of the year 2000, a date that we'll talk about a little bit later. So what is Marvin doing once he kidnaps these kids? Well, we know from Care NLM's in-game description in Petscop 9 that, quote, Care NLM escaped from the school's basement and wandered the Newmaker plane for days, end quote. Escaped from the school's basement? What does that mean? Well, in episode 3, we actually visit her room and find out, quote again, a young person walks into your school building. They walk in with you. You're holding their hands. They come out crying into their hands because nobody will love them. Not ever again. Nobody loves me. They wander the Newmaker plane. Last episode, we established that the you being talked about here in these notes is Marvin. Rainer made this game for him to see.
Well, this part of the game was made for somebody to see.
Which means that Marvin is a teacher who abducts children and takes them back to his classroom or a basement in the school. First Michael, then Care, and then does something to them that makes them unlovable. Something that ruins them. Turns them into NLM status. But what is he doing? Well, I'm sure you could be imagining any number of awful things that a guy could be doing to these kids in the basement of the school, but here's where it starts to get a bit odd. In video 2, our Let's Player Paul finds a device named Tool under the New Maker plane, which gives him the ability to ask questions. Now, most of his questions don't yield all that much information, until Petscop 7, when Tool suddenly turns pink and starts talking on its own, as if it's possessed, saying,
"Turn off PlayStation. Marvin picks up Tool hurts me when PlayStation on. I love you, New Maker. Please show Marvin where his house is. Go there and he'll follow you. His daughter is there. Also wants 1,000 pieces for Machine Beyond School Basement Stairway."
So he's not only hurting the kids, but he's also putting them into some sort of machine. It's also worth noting that this pink Tool who's asking for help, by process of elimination, must be the voice of yet another child. I mean, it can't be Mike, since we just walked past his gravestone. And it can't be Care, because she's crying in NLM form under the shack. This means that there must be a third victim. Someone else who's been captured and tortured by Marvin. And based on Petscop 12, we know exactly who it is. A girl. A girl named Belle. A girl who we know somehow manages to escape. Quote, "Hi Belle, you're free! I left these messages for you to look at in case you were ever rescued." And it's these messages to the rescued Belle in Petscop 12 that actually reveal a lot about the plot when you read between the lines. First, we know that these messages are coming from Rainer himself, since he specifically mentions features that he programmed into the game. Quote again, "You're not family, so I didn't add your traits to the face system. That means I didn't add your eyes, or your eyebrows, or your nose." Now that revelation right there also drops a huge bombshell on the dynamic of this game. Michael Hammond isn't just Rainer's dead young brother, he's also part of Marvin's family. I mean, think about it, the text box says only family have their features in the game's facial system. And since we know Mike's features are in there, his nose and eyebrows, as well as Care's features in there, it means that Rainer, Care, Michael, and Marvin are all related. In short, that one line tells us that Petscop is the tale of a broken family, a family dealing with the consequences of their abusive father. But that's not all. The family connection also ties in with our player, Paul.
But when I found my room, I was shocked at first, but it made sense.
In that line, Paul explicitly states that he found a room dedicated to him in the game, meaning that now he too is also a part of this family. He also mentions that he and Care look a lot alike, and just so happen to be the same age.
I remember you saying that we are, exactly the same age. I do agree there's a resemblance, very strong resemblance between us.
The game seems to run in the family, as Rainer reappears multiple times throughout the timeline to deliver it on Christmas Day. First, on Christmas Day 1997, which we see in the frozen house, and again on Christmas Day in the year 2000. Paul actually mentions in episode 8 that his mom was the one with the game, which she had back in 2004.
Well, it could have changed between then and 2004. After 2004, my mom had it reportedly.
So Petscop is basically the equivalent of a family heirloom. Rainer's chronicle of the bad behavior that his father committed that he now passes down between generations. Secondly though, the lines that Rainer programmed into the game for Belle show that Marvin's machine is somehow tied to playing music. Quote again, "I was overeager before, and started calling you Tiara prematurely. I created a space for you in the menu, still unused now. Then I put you inside the machine and played the second movement of Stravinsky's Septet on the Needles. I played it wrong, but that would have been okay. If you hadn't given up halfway, you would be Tiara. This is not what happened, and now I'm gone." End quote. The machine's connection to music is further supported by hidden images sprinkled throughout the game's various loading screens. At first glance, most of the loading screens simply look black, and yet, throughout the entirety of the 13 episodes, there are hidden images that reveal themselves when the screen is brightened or the exposure is cranked up. What you find are real-life equivalents of key in-game objects and places. The bedroom layout that we see in the Quitter's room, wooden stairs leading into a basement just like the ones we descend in-game to get to the New Maker plane, a piano with a PlayStation controller connected to it, someone being forced to play the piano, and Marvin's face. Or perhaps Marvin's mask. I doubt in real life his face is literally that green. So what's really going on here? What is all this about a piano? Well, it seems like Marvin steals kids, often his own kids, to rebirth the most promising candidates into Tiara, his friend from decades prior, the Windmill Girl. It began with his son Mike, plucking his eyebrows to best recreate Tiara's hairless face. And we know that he did this based on the tweezers that are found hidden in Michael's room. When that one didn't work out, Marvin moved on to Care, whose natural lack of eyebrows made her an exciting prospect. As we can see from a note in the back of her room, quote, "Your wife says, Care isn't growing eyebrows. You say, that's a puzzle. You're secretly very excited to hear this news. You're in the bathtub thinking about her. I have a guess at which child you'll pick next." That last line there clearly indicates that Care is definitely not the first child to undergo this procedure. Now, once at school, he forces the kids into the basement, which we see in the real-life loading screen image descending a wooden staircase. Then he gets them to play music that somehow is tied to this bizarre rebirthing process. As evidenced by the hidden real-life photo in the loading screens, he specifically forces them to play the piano. Those who fail are punished by getting locked into the real-life version of the Quitter's Room, something that Rainer recreates in the game. That's where Belle is imprisoned at the beginning of the series, and where she's rescued from in episode 12. While under his watch, Marvin motivates his students to do better, not by using a controlled shock, but rather by using tool, or rather, a tool, which appears to be an awl. A tool that's used for punching holes in leather and wood, but also, fittingly enough, a tool that's often included in piano tuning kits. This is the cycle of abuse he creates, all in his attempts to rebirth his long-lost love, Tiara. And that's the way it continues for decades, at least until Rainer's game. But the story doesn't conclude the way you might think. You see, Petscop doesn't seem content to just retell the story of Marvin's crimes. Like Paul says,
"This game is trying very hard to make it seem like there's an entity in it."
And he's not wrong. Petscop seems to be able to act on its own. We see Marvin's in-game avatar literally able to manipulate the level editor in Video 6. We also know that this is Marvin talking by the language that he's using in the game. Notice how he phrases his questions. Where is my house? Where is the school? My house. Marvin's house. He's trapped. And now, he's looking for a means of escape. It appears that Rainer made Petscop to stop Marvin's violent acts not by simply exposing him, but by trapping him inside the game. Petscop is Marvin's prison, and the demo screen at the end of Petscop 12 confirms it. If you watch until the absolute last second of that video, there are a few frames that reveal the pause menu for the demo screen, and you can see that there is no escape available. Unlike when Paul's playing, when the pause menu has a quit game option, the demo screen doesn't. The demo players are literally trapped inside the game. So how'd Rainer get Marvin trapped inside the game to begin with? Admittedly, it's definitely a bit unclear, but I'd say it has to do with the PlayStation controller attached to the piano that we saw during one of the loading screens. I'm honestly not 100% sure, but knowing that Marvin's machine is tied to music, that he forces kids to play the piano, and knowing it's the one place where we see music and video game cross in real-life imagery, that seems to be important. Regardless, based on the way Marvin's avatar behaves in the game, it seems undeniable that he's the entity who's trapped inside of this code. So, does that mean Petscop served its purpose? Does it mean that Rainer won by capturing Marvin inside the game? Well, yeah. And no. You see, the game is still out there. And like any good creepypasta, that leaves open the possibility of a tragic conclusion. And in this case, it seems like it might be falling on Paul's hands. We see Marvin in Petscop 8 trying to communicate to Paul, leading him to a picture of the school and his house, trying to walk into a wall to show Paul the way to get there. Marvin is trying to use Paul to escape, or at the very least, to make Paul into the new Marvin in the real world. I mean, just stop and think. Even after Paul watches Marvin kidnap Care, going so far as to say, Paul, given the same opportunity, does the exact same thing. He literally does exactly what Marvin just did. In fact, Marvin is literally training Paul throughout the course of this series. Remember in Petscop 5 when Pink Tool tells Paul,
"Marvin picks up Tool hurts me when PlayStation on."
Well, that establishes that Paul knows that by keeping the PlayStation on, he's causing someone pain, but he doesn't stop it for a second. He doesn't turn it off. And that's because Paul is Marvin reborn. That's why we see multiple scenes of Marvin teaching Paul, or Pal, as the game says. Marvin may not be able to escape, but it seems like Paul will be able to carry on his dirty work for him. So there you have it. Rainer versus Marvin, son versus father, a tale of loss, murder, and piano controllers. In the end, it is Rainer who comes out on top, but still, this all begs the question, when can we expect the next installment? Well, apparently it happened earlier this week. I forgot the series was having a one-year anniversary, so, you know, I may have been a bit wrong in my prediction there. But I do stand by my actual prediction that you should keep an eye on the Petscop channel around June 5th of this year. This game plays with dates a lot, and June 5th is the pivotal moment of Care's disappearance, so that seems like it's gonna be the perfect time to continue this story. If at this point it even wants to be continued, because episode 13 really did have an air of finality to it. Anyway, in the meantime, here's something I'd love to discuss that I'm just throwing here at the end of the video because 13 just came out and I haven't had enough time to really process it. There's a crucial point in episode 13 where Blue Tool becomes Black Tool and is then used to unlock something on the table outside of Care's room. Notice how the green chain links disappear after Black Tool flies towards those objects. And we know that this is on June 5th, the day of Care's kidnapping. Most interestingly of all, we know that unlocking these objects is important enough to get rewarded with a bunch of pieces, just like when Windmill Girl died. But what are those things left on the table? It looks like a speaker system and a new microphone to me. Who knows? I'm still working on what it could mean. Anyway, let me know what you think in the comments below. Obviously, there are still a lot of details to work through on this one. And who knows? Now that this episode went up, maybe Petscop 14 is gonna be released tomorrow. Something tells me that it won't, but hey, crazier things have happened. It's like Paul is the new Scott Cawthon. Anyway, in the meantime, remember, that's just a theory. A game theory. Thanks for watching.